worship our Lord and our Savior. Bless his holy name, as he has been good to us all week long. All week. Let's pray. Our great God in heaven, thank you so much. Lord, what you have done already, we just say thank you. God, as we come now and open your word that we are privileged as people to have, we pray for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Pray, God, that you will speak, Lord, and our ears will be open to listen to whatever you have to say, God. Father, now we just expect something amazing to happen. We expect life transformation as we open your word. We expect healing as we open your word. We expect new hearts as we open your word, God. May we never be the same because we've been in your presence now, Lord. Soften our hearts, Lord. Open our minds as you speak, God, to us these wonderful words of life. In Jesus' name. All God's people said,
Amen.
We all have a picture of what a mom and dad are supposed to be like. Caring, listening, tender, strong, working, bringing home the bacon, since we're Adventists, strimples. I thought how I was going to say that. You know, as being a parent, a mom and dad, it is a high calling that God puts on us. Children, raising children. I'll tell you this, it doesn't stop at 18, if you don't know already. It's a ministry, I'm going to call it a ministry, that lasts forever. And Paul, as we look at today in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, as we dive into God's Word, he talks about the church, you and me, being mothers and fathers to each other. Because Paul, Silas, and Timothy treated the converts in Thessalonica like a mom and dad would treat their own child. Which he's given us the example that we need to be like mothers and fathers with each other and those outside the church as well. And as we go through this chapter, as we begin this chapter today, 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, you can either follow along on the screen, or if you have your Bibles and you want to open them up, or your iPad, your iPhone, wherever you read your Bible at, 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. Paul and his companions, Silas and Timothy, they had their haters in Thessalonica and Philippi, as we will see. People would slander them. People wanted them dead. Why? Because all they were doing was preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. I mean, look at what he says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. And verse 2 is what we're going to begin today. 1 Thessalonians 2 and verse 2. He says, you know how badly we had been treated at Philippi just before we came to you and how much we suffered there. So they were treated badly at Philippi and how much they suffered there. Why? All because of preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Before we came to you, we told you everything that happened to us at Philippi. How much we suffered there. Which is interesting because at this time, when Paul was in Philippi and his companions, they were in prison. They suffered great anguish at Philippi just for preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Paul, in his mind, probably thinks that death would have been a welcome relief. Just before we came to you, we suffered for the gospel of Jesus Christ. But if we know Paul and all the other apostles, They praise the Lord for suffering in the name of Jesus. But look at what he says. In verse 2, it goes on. He says, "Yet our God gave us the courage to declare his good news, to declare his gospel to you, those in Thessalonica, boldly, in spite of great opposition." But then he goes on and he says this. He says, verse 1, he says, "You yourselves know, dear brothers and sisters, all of you in Thessalonica, that our visit to you was not a failure." Paul and Silas and Timothy had great opposition there. And they said that God gave us great courage, great boldness to come to Thessalonica, even in the midst of all this opposition, to preach the gospel to you. And he says, look, our visit to you, our preaching to you, our being a mom and dad to you was not a failure. Why? Because God's word, when you preach it, when you share it with others, the Bible says that God's word will not return void. It will accomplish what God sends it out to accomplish. Their coming to preach to Thessalonica, it was productive, but it was productive only because of God. It was not a failure only because of God. Now, does that mean that everybody at Thessalonica converted? No. Just like, just like Noah, preaching for 120 years. How many converts did he have? Have none outside of his family. Yeah, none outside of his family. Let's be bold about our answer. Yeah. It's all right. But God accomplished what he wanted to accomplish. People have choices, you know. I mean, if you preach the gospel to someone, if you give them a Bible study, and they don't come, and they're like, "I don't believe that." It's okay. Don't feel like you're a failure just because somebody doesn't believe what you're telling them. It's all right. Paul says, look, we came and we preached the gospel, and the Lord gave the fruit. It was not a failure. I tell you this, brothers and sisters, if you share the gospel for 20 years and all you have is you win one person to the Lord, that's not a failure. Amen. But Paul says, even in the midst of all this, it was not a failure. We came to you even in the midst of opposition, even in the midst of all the threats, and even in the midst of everything that was going on, all the suffering and everything, we come to preach the gospel because we wanted you to know about Jesus and his good news and the hope he gives to everyone. He says, look, now he's talking about all the opposition that was going on, all the haters that was happening, all that they were saying. He says, look, in verse 3, he says, so you can see, when we were preaching the gospel, we didn't do it with any deceit or impure motive or trickery. He says, for we speak as messengers approved by God to be entrusted with the good news or the gospel. Our purpose is to please God and not people. He alone examines the motives of our hearts. We did not use flattery. We were not preaching, we were not pretending to be your friends. As for human praise, we have never sought it from you or anyone else. Paul comes along and he says, look, they can say all this. They can say, look, they're just pretending to be your friends. They don't believe in what they're saying. They're tricking you into believing a gospel that is not true. And Paul says, look, we didn't flatter you. We didn't pretend to be your friends. Nor did we seek out any praise from you or anyone else. We're here only to please God and to share the gospel with you so you can have hope. Amen. And brothers and sisters, when I read that, that's the way we need to be in 2019 today. We don't need to pretend to be people's friends just so they will join the church. Hey, look. If we're somebody's friend and they say, I'm not joining your church or I don't believe your gospel, still be their friend. We're not here to make friends with the hook. We're here to be friends, whether they join the church or believe in Jesus or not. We're not here to flatter people either. And we're not here to win praises from man. We're here to preach the gospel and please the Lord. Paul and his companions were being slandered because of what they were doing preaching the gospel. Have you ever been slandered before? Or your motives questioned as far as preaching the gospel? Let me tell you. It's happened to me. I remember back in Washington, we were doing Bible studies with this couple. Their daughter had joined the church. And we started giving Bible studies to her mom and dad. Things were going great. We were becoming friends. We were showing them like the love of Jesus and teaching them about this wonderful truth about the Sabbath. You know, that we told them it's a vacation day that you get every week. You know, and that the grave is not the end. You know, there's hope beyond the grave. That the grave of death does not get the last say. That Jesus is coming, is going to take us to heaven. And all this sickness and all this, everything is going to be done away with. And they were eating it up and just loving it and coming to church. And then all of a sudden, I don't know what happened. It was like something switched. And all of a sudden, they begin to use Facebook, slandering myself and the church. And the daughter, I mean, I won't even go into what they were saying, but it was awful. And the daughter was like, "Did you read what my mom and dad put on Facebook?" I said, "Yeah, I saw that." "Oh, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry." I was like, "You don't need to apologize for anything." I said, "Hey, it's to be expected. It's going to happen." I said, "If you preach the gospel, if you do Bible study with somebody," I said, "I guarantee you, you do it with 10 people, one person is going to say something about you on Facebook." I said, "Here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray for your mom and dad. And I said, we're going to continue to move forward, doing what God has called us to do." I remember one other time, I told you the story about Jack, Joey's coach, and how we were praying for him, and myself and the head elder went over to his house. And we went over there several times, and we would sit for like an hour or so just talking to him. And just talking to him and how things were going. And he began to talk about his will and about his money that he had. And his daughter who was there, who was living with him and helping take care of him, she got up and went outside. Went out on the porch. And we probably stayed probably about 15, 20 minutes later, or afterwards after she went on the porch. And as we were leaving, we stepped down off on the steps onto the ground. And she says to me and the head elder, George, she says, "How much money did he give you?" And I went like this. "What?" She says, "Did he give you lots of money?" I said, "What are you talking about?" She says, "Isn't that why you're here? Isn't that what pastors and churches are after? Just our money?" I said, "Let me tell you this. I said, I'm not after your money and neither is the church. I said, as a matter of fact, I don't want any of your money. I said, I don't come over here to become your friend or Jack's friend just so I can get his money. I said, I do it because I care about him and about you. I said, even if he or you gave me money, I would not accept it anyway because I am not here for money." She's like, "What? Really? You're not after our money?" I said, "I'm not after your money. I don't want your money. Even after that, we continued to go over there to his home and continue to be his friend. And she opened up after that. When she found out that our motives were not to get his money, she opened up and became more friendly. She went out on the porch less and less and less, and she sat there with us. You see, brothers and sisters, when you, like Paul and like Silas and Timothy, when you preach the gospel, people are going to slander you. People are going to question your motives. You just keep preaching the gospel. Continue to be friends with people. Continue to work to please God and not men. It's going to happen. Jesus went through the same thing. Look, they call him Beelzebub and a wine bearer. They said that he, why is he sinning with sinners? He's a glutton. And Jesus just kept on going, doing what God called him to do. In the midst of it all. But watch this, though. So Paul sets it up. He says, even through all the trials and tribulation that we went through, everything else, we preached the gospel to you. We didn't care about that. We didn't use flattery. We didn't pretend to be your friends. We didn't look for human praise at all. Now watch what Paul says next. As apostles of Christ, we certainly had a right to make some demands of you, but instead we were like children among you, or we were like a mother feeding and caring for her children. We loved you so much that we shared with you not only God's good news or the gospel, but our own lives too. Paul says that he and his companions, Paul, Silas, and Timothy, were like what? Mothers. They were like mothers feeding and caring for their own children. A mother that gives her own lives for those in Thessalonica. It's interesting that Paul uses this description of what him and Silas and Timothy are doing in Thessalonica. They're like mothers to their children. If there's one thing I know about a mother, it's this. A mother's work is never done. I thought all the moms would say amen to that.
We're too tired.
Well, we'll just skip right on over to the fathers then, and we'll leave this one there. A mother's work is never done. Right? It's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. A mother is a listener. It's amazing. Let me just tell you this. It's amazing. I mean, when Tara comes home, if they work outside the home or whether they don't work outside the home, but when Tara, she works outside the home, when she comes home, it's like she's catching her second wind. It is. It's like she comes home and she puts her purse on the table and got a second wind. Because all of a sudden she begins cleaning, she begins cooking, she begins listening to me, she's a counselor to our children. I mean, it's just like all this, you know, and it's like she never sits down. I remember when she worked outside the home as the kids were growing up. And, you know, and mothers are doctors as well. They get a scrape on the, if the kids get a scrape on their knee or whatever the case may be, they never run to the fathers. It's like they cry and cry and cry. And I'm like, Joey, what's the matter? Elisa, what's the matter? Well, what happened? Where's Mama? And then they don't want me. So they come and Tara's got this medicine. I don't know what they call it. It's a spray something. And then they put a Band-Aid on it. Or I remember as a kid, do you remember this? The red stuff that had the stick and the I don't know what that was called. Iodine or whatever. I called it fire on my knee. My mom and dad used to tell me, stop crying, it'll make you feel better. Well, it hurts. But you see, here's the thing about mothers. There are all these things and more. Mothers, listen, mothers give and give and give and give and give and give and give. They give their whole lives. They give their whole lives. They give all of their time, all of their energy, everything to make sure their children and their husband have. They do. It's never done. They wake up in the morning and they start all over again. Mothers give. And that's what Paul and his companions did with Thessalonica. He was like a mother to them. He was giving their own lives. Why? So the people in Thessalonica could have. And brothers and sisters, when I read this, this is what Paul is telling us that we need to be like with each other and with those outside the church. We need to give of our lives. We need to give of our time, our energy, to make sure that our church family has. Amen. Even those who are seeking the gospel, even those who are wanting to know Jesus Christ outside the church, we need to be able to give and give and give. Brothers and sisters, to be an evangelist like God calls us to be the priesthood of all believers, it costs us something. It costs us time. It costs us energy. It costs us inconvenience to make sure that people have the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Sometimes when you come home at 5 o'clock in the afternoon or you're sitting on a Sunday watching whatever you're watching, and someone calls up and says, look, I need help. I know. I'm a human being. I know the first thing that we all do. Oh, but it's Sunday. Why didn't I answer my phone? Why didn't I look at it? I should have saw the name. Why didn't I put that name in my phone instead of just 919? I know. But brothers and sisters, look. 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 We need to be willing like mothers to just have the extra energy and time to be the mother that we're all looking for. Every one of us are looking. Wanting a mother. I'm telling you. And we need to be like Paul and say, look. Say, like, look. We were like a mother feeding and caring for her children. We loved you so much. We loved you so much. We need to love each other so much that we share the good news and our own lives too. That's what it's all about. That's what church is about. That's what church is about. Being like a mother. Being like a mother feeding and caring for each other. Making sure that we have. Making sure that our church family has. Making sure that those who seek the gospel of Jesus Christ have. We need to be able to give our own lives to. Our own lives. That's what church is all about, brothers and sisters. Look, when I read that same thing in Acts chapter 2. Right during Pentecost. If someone didn't have, they would sell what they have and give their funds to whomever needed it. It may mean, look, that you go out to eat one less time during the week and take that $30, $40, $50 and making sure someone else has food. Because that's what mothers do. Mothers make sure that their children have, even if they have to do without. But Paul goes on, and he says, you yourselves are our witness that we were devout, honest, and faultless toward all you believers. And you know that we treated each of you, look, now look, he said, we treated you as a mother. Now look at what he says. And you know that we treated each of you as a father treats his own children. How was that? We pleaded with you. We encouraged you. and urge you to live lives that God would consider worthy. Paul says, look, not only were we like a mother to you, but we were also like a father to you. We pleaded with you, which means, in the Greek, it means that we give you advice. We encourage you, which in the Greek means that we console and comfort you. We also urge you, or we insist to you, to live a worthy life. You see, fathers are strong, protective, and they're the leadership type. You see, as a dad myself with Joey and Elisa, we would talk about their future. They would often ask me, they would say, Dad, what if I did this? And I would say, look, I don't care what you do, just so long as it's legal. Just be legal. I would encourage them to do anything. I would tell them the sky is the limit, and as their dad, I have their back. I would sit and I would let them know through text or whatever that I'm praying for them, that I want them to live a life worthy of how the gospel says to live life. Amen. I'm there for them. Tara's there for them. And as an evangelist, as a church, each of us need to be like a father to each other. People are wanting to know. People love when they ask for it. Good advice. People want to be consoled and comforted when they're hurting. They want to know that you, as their church member, as their family, have their back. That you long for them to live a life that God would consider worthy, so everyone can be in heaven. That you'll protect them, that you'll know that you're there for them. We need to be like a father to each of us. We need to plead. We need to encourage. And we need to urge them on. Because every one of us is going to have a bad day. Every one of us is going to stumble and fall. And we don't need pointing and laughing or gossiping. We need to know that someone has our back and can pick us up and urge us on. That we are there for each other. Because that's what a father does. That's what a mother does. And you see, being a part of this ministry, being a father and a mother to each other and to those who are outside the church, brothers and sisters, being a parent is a never-ending ministry. It's never-ending. Why? Because we're dealing with people, and people never end. It takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of patience. And it takes a lot of encouraging. You see, here's what I believe, though. Here's what I believe about the ministry of mother and father in the church. Is this here. That every one of us sitting here and those outside the church, people are looking for parents. People are looking for a mother and a father. People are looking for someone who will just be their friend and be there for them. And help them, and pray for them, and love them, and encourage them, and plead with them, and comfort them, and console them. And as us, as God is calling us to be mothers and fathers to our church members and to those outside the church, we need to know that every child is different. Joey and Elisa were different. And everyone is reached differently. I believe that when we become mothers and fathers to each other, not that we tell everyone what to do, not that we're over each other, but that we're there for each other. Just like what Paul and Silas and Timothy had in Thessalonica, it will be a ministry that can only produce fruit. And it's a ministry that never ends, and it's a ministry with great rewards. You see, it's a high calling to be a mother and a father. It's a high calling. We want to be excellent parents to our natural children. And brothers and sisters, God is calling us to be mothers and fathers to each other. Excellent parents to each other. To help one another out. To love one another. And to be there for one another. And know that it's a ministry that never ends. But a ministry that will produce fruit until Jesus comes again.
Amen. Christ's name.